Now, one thing I love about SandboxAQ is that we are at the nexus of two really amazing fields. Now, as a mathematician, I love that because I also enjoy working not just in one field, but really at the bridge where two realms of mathematics intersect. I think when you start blending ideas and blending tools, that's a really fascinating place to be. And I know that you and I share a love of mathematics too, right?
Absolutely. And I'll talk in a bit about my love of mathematics, but let's start with yourself, Tai-Danae. What are some of the branches of mathematics? There's so many, you know, mathematics is so wonderful because it is not constrained necessarily by physical experiment, right? In physics, we have a somewhat limited body of information and data because we have to focus on what works in the experiment. But in mathematics, we can build anything we want to. And so mathematics has really flourished, particularly in the last 30, 40 years. We've seen an incredible explosion of mathematics in topology and category theory in so many areas. Talk about some of the areas of mathematics, the branches of mathematics, and particularly these bridges between them that you get excited about.
Yeah, well, one thing that's incredible is that even though there are different realms in the space of mathematics, you kind of feel like they're islands. There are no islands in mathematics. So there are kind of bridges, like you were saying. And the amazing thing, though, when you start to transport ideas from one realm of math to the other, you discover that the bridge across which you transport ideas is also mathematics. And that math has a name that's called category theory, as you mentioned. And sometimes category theory is described as the mathematics of mathematics, because what it sort of does is it lifts you off the ground and kind of gives you a 30,000 viewpoint of all of the different ideas in math. You kind of discover that over the years, mathematicians kind of do the same thing, but they just use different language. And so category.
So we're talking about kind of, to help the audience, an abstraction in a way.
Exactly.
Right?
It's very abstract. It's very abstract, which could, you know, some folks have said, oh, I'm allergic to category theory because it's so abstract. But when you start to see really the ideas that it's conveying, it's really, really beautiful. And it sort of gives you a new perspective to see things that maybe you couldn't quite see when you are down at the ground level, and you really need to take that bird's eye perspective to see how things are connected. When you see that, you start to understand the nexus between fields, which is basically where Sandbox is at.
And what are some of the other math fields that get you excited?
Yeah, so I love
to... You wrote a book about topology.
Yes,
talk about that.
Yes, so I co-authored a book with my PhD advisor, John Tarilla, and Tyler Bryson, who is a student of John at the time. We wrote a book, graduate-level textbook, on topology. What is topology? I like to think of it as like a squishy version of geometry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in geometry, we deal with shapes, circles, triangles. In topology, we say, look, you can pretend your shapes are made of Play-Doh. You can kind of stretch them or squeeze them. Turns out, topology and category theory are closely related. In fact, category theory was born in the 1940s because of a problem in topology. It kind of naturally came around, these ideas. And so the funny thing is, though, whenever you take an undergraduate or even a graduate-level course in topology, this kind of cousin of geometry, usually don't use category theory in it, which is so funny because historically, you know, they go hand in hand.
Correct.
So John Tarilla, he kind of said, look, we got to fix this problem, you know, let's write a book. So we wrote that book. I like thinking of those ideas. I'm a very visual mathematician. I just love seeing pictures and how they connect to the ideas. I also really enjoy algebra. So when I say algebra, folks might think, oh, x squared plus, no. That's one way to think of it. But algebra is really just this idea of combining things in some way to get a new thing. You know, I take two buckets of paint, I smush them together, I get more paint. But you see this all the time in the real world too. You know, I have two qubits, I entangle them in some way, and now I have a new system. This is like an algebraic structure a little bit. So you see this in other places too, like even in natural language. You know, speaking of artificial intelligence, why is it that you can give a whole bunch of data, text data, to a neural network, and it can now speak like a human? How is that possible? You didn't tell it what a noun was. You didn't say, oh, gravity, we have this thing called gravity, so apples fall. No, it just knew. How did it know that? Well, the only thing it has access to is the algebraic structure of language. What words go with what, and you know, with what frequencies, probabilities. So that's mathematics. Mathematics is everywhere. Folks happen to give them names like algebra, topology, category theory.
But it's all connected.
They're all connected. And seeing those connections, I think, is really fascinating.
No, that's great. And the work you're doing is so essential, which is why we're excited to have that right here at SandboxAQ and to incorporate a lot of mathematics. And fundamentally, underneath quantum, underneath AI, is all mathematics. And as you know, I've been very passionate about a number of areas of mathematics, and I teach and been writing about now textbooks for linear algebra and for number theory, in particular, those two areas. And linear algebra, and you and I have talked about this in terms of how to improve math education, and now maybe we can address that a little bit here, in terms of linear algebra is typically taught in a very dry way in math departments, and people take these courses as requirements sometimes. If you're a physics major or a computer science major or other majors, you're taking this. But it's disconnected in how it's taught to the wonderful life that linear algebra has inside machine learning, that is deep learning, neural networks, which can all be phrased and put in the context of linear algebra, and also in terms of quantum mechanics, which itself fundamentally is put into the context of linear algebra as well. And so this wonderful connectivity, in fact, we've been now teaching a course, linear algebra for machine learning and quantum, which is not a course you normally see out there in universities, but we're hoping to start to make these connections for students so they get more excited about this kind of mathematics. Now let's turn to number theory as another example. Number theory, of course, as some viewers will know, is the underlying mathematics of cryptography. And now that we have quantum attacks on this kind of cryptography based on factoring and other such such areas, we now have to think about other kinds of mathematics, particularly lattice-based mathematics, which again brings us back to some of the linear algebra that we began with. And so this connectivity that drives artificial intelligence, that drives quantum mechanics, that can help us visualize and abstract, as you talk about, these very, very significant areas all comes down back to mathematics. And one thing you and I have talked about now coming back to mathematics education is how we can improve mathematics education. I think there's been an obsession at the high school level for advanced students for calculus. And certainly I love calculus, and I'm sure you do as well. But we're missing a number of areas of connectivity of mathematics. For example, statistics, which again drives a lot of machine learning, and linear algebra, which drives machine learning, which again, I find students that we teach, even high school students that we teach, they find it very exciting to learn about machine learning. And a lot of the applications thereof, which are much more immediate often than a calculus type course, which can be quite abstract and doesn't necessarily have the kind of applications.
Exactly.
Immediately. And any thoughts on that?
The funny thing is, though, you don't even need calculus to learn linear algebra, right? And yet they usually hold it off and usually...
Till after calculus.
Exactly. Yeah. And yeah. By that point, students might think, well, I don't like math. And they never actually get to,
yeah,
to,
exactly.
to that part.
So one of our, I think, joint goals, yeah. I think it's fair to say, is to see if we can flip that,
yeah.
right? To see if we can get linear algebra taught before calculus. So if this video maybe can do its part in sending a ripple out to the universe... and maybe some deans of schools can hear us and principals of high schools can hear us. But we, at the forefront of a lot of these technologies, would strongly encourage schools to think about placing linear algebra before calculus. It's a wonderful area, and certainly an area that we find in teaching, I think, a lot of excitement, it's fair to say.
Yep, definitely.
Cool. Excellent. Well, thanks so much.
Thank you.